All right, so I got bored in the house tonight. So I'm going to go ahead and start taking apart the YZ, take the plastics off, the seat off, some of the simple stuff that I know that I need to get into to be able to get to everything. I might drain the fluids tonight. I brought the pan. I might not. I might get just before the draining fluids and then stop. We'll see as I start getting into it, but I'm going to start taking it apart slowly and start getting it ready. So I'm getting it started to be teared down, get all the plastics and stuff in a box. The silencer was the next thing, and so now, of course, I'm sidetracked, and I want to see just how clogged up and schmooched up this sucker is, because it definitely has got some packing issues going on. I've got the packing, so we're going to go ahead and pop it apart and take a look. It looks like it's silicone. I don't have any silicone to redo it. So we may have to wait to put it back together, but we can at least take it apart and look and see just how nasty, gooey it is inside there. Well, now that is far, far different than I thought I was gonna open up and see this. Yes, it is black and schmooty, but I mean, it's not even half black and oiled up. I thought it was going to be way, way worse than that. I thought half of it was going to be gone and all of it was going to be super black and plugged. That looks really good compared to what I thought it was going to look. When we took the CR silencer apart, there was only like, 3 inches of packing, and the rest of it was all burned to a crisp and gone and oily and nasty. So that actually looks better than I thought it was going to. So I got a large chunk of the outside after cutting it. I got a large chunk of it off, but there's still a lot stuck on this thing. And boy, is it gooey. Gooey, gooey, gooey. So let me get the rest of this off here. And when you get sick and tired of scraping and getting completely filthy, just light it on fire. Just grab the propane torch and burn it. I don't know any other way to get this crap off. I did the same thing with the CR silencer. It's the only thing that really gets it off there and get it crisp and burnt off. It's so packed on and so tight you can't even see the holes in the metal yet. Alright, so after taking her out and burning the piss out of her, we're to where we stand now. I still got a little bit of it to get left out. Just down in where I couldn't really get at it with the flame very good. But the rest of it's all open back up again. Barbecue scraper did wonders, so I just got to get some of this last on here. And this stock packing, it almost like a wire. It's steel wool. It reminds me an awful lot of steel wool. It's like almost metal, fire retardant stuff. It acts like a lot like steel wool. When you get it hot, it turns bright red, but it's not burning. It just gets hot, and then when you let it cool, then it's like little pieces of wire. So pretty weird stuff. So get the last of it out, and then we'll throw in some fresh. And I suppose I should give you a gander down inside the actual can. And inside the can, it's super clean. Tiny bits of oil, if any, you know. The actual nozzle has never really leaked out too much or really dripped spooge. As you can tell, it has some, but it's never been real bad because the joint where this goes into the pipe always has leaked. So the bike has always leaked right here, and you can see all the spooge and everything right from where the main pipe connects to the silencer. So I think that's what saved a lot of it from coming all the way out the end of the pipe, is because it was leaking in between. So anyway, that's all pretty clean and everything. So I got the rest of that steel wool garbage out of there. So I think we're ready now to go ahead and open up the new package of FMF packing and get a wrap. All right, before we get going, the difference between this FMF packing and the stock packing that was in there is like night and day difference, dude. This is like that fake snow stuff you get for building villages around Christmas time. Like, it's just super light and fluffy, airy. I assume it's, good stuff. It's FMF and they use it in all their two-strokes, but way different material than the stock one had in it. So I'm hoping that this will make the bike sound good and still have packing. I don't know how long it'll last. We'll find out, but I just wanted to comment on, wow, what a way different material. Very, very soft and spongy-like compared to that stuff that was like a solid brick, like you could pinch it and it was just solid, and it's all that almost steel wool type stuff. So way different material. Let's go ahead and get this wrapped around here and cut to length, and then we'll cram it all back together. All right, so this is the last time you'll see the pretty silencer packing. I don't have any masking tape. All my masking tape I had in here went bad. It all stuck together, so I threw it away. So I'm just gonna go ahead and go straight on into the canister, get everything lined up, but that's the whole roll minus that much, because it was that much too long, it would have stuck clear out past the end of the pipe. So trim that little bit, and the rest of it is the whole pack of packing, so we'll get it crammed together. All right, so step number one, or check mark one thing off the list, all repacked, freshened up. I'm not gonna take the time to polish it up or anything, because this is a practice bike and it gets many, many hours on it. But old packing out, old nasty, packed with freaking caster, two-stroke splits, and in with clean, nice, ready to rock. All right, went ahead and got the pipe off the bike. One of the things I was curious about is this piece that couples the pipe to the silencer. I thought maybe it was cracked or broken. I don't see any cracks or brokenness to it. It just doesn't seal good. I already wiped this off a little bit, but that was just caked. And this whole thing is just caked with soot, and it just doesn't seal very good between the two. So I know it was put on wrong when I first got the bike from the dealership. I quickly fixed it, but it still didn't really seal up anything anyway good. So I don't know. We'll see about, maybe I'll get a new one, or maybe we'll put a big ass hose clamp around it instead of the small little, you know, I guess they're supposed to be springs, but they're not very, very tight. So I don't know, but it's not broken like I thought it was. I thought it was torn. I thought like it had a tear in it or something where it was leaking out, but I don't see anything like that. So pretty interesting. And then no seals up or leaks up here around the front of the pipe. None of this is sooted up or nasty at all. So it's been sealing really good against the head. That's good news. So we'll go see if I can dump any oil out of the pipe, if there's any actual amount of oil that's actually going to be pouring out of it. And if not, then we'll be good to go. Take it right here. Oh, there was a little bit dripped out. Like two drips. Yep, there ain't enough inside that pipe to even imagine or even worry about. It was like two little drips or two pieces of dirt right off the bat, but it isn't running so rich that it soots up the whole pipe or gets the whole thing nasty filled with oil. It's just running a little rich. Well, you know what we got to do now. We got the pipe off the bike. We got a little tiny window to see in. We got to take a gander. I'm kind of trying to look through the viewfinder of the phone, and I can't really, it doesn't look like anything's really in focus. Focus up in there, come on. Okay, so that's the piston down. That camera isn't going to do a very good job of focusing up in there. But there's our first little sneak peek. First little look. There's the piston and the ring. Looking pretty nice. As far as I can see. That's the, not the bottom of the piston, but we're at top dead now. It's about to come back down. Yeah, everything looked good from what I can see on my camera anyway. We'll get it all torn apart and take a look at it in depth. But when you get this far, you just have to look up in there, right? That's just part of the deal. Get this spring rehung up here. Perfect. So All I pretty much have left to do now is drain the fluids. Go ahead and get the antifreeze and everything out of the top end of it. I may not even do the gear oil. Just leave it all sitting down in the bottom and get the antifreeze and everything out of the top end. Pull the top off and take a look. Yeah. So anybody that watches my normal maintenance vids knows that we just got through doing this air filter, right? We just got through taking it out, cleaning it, re-oiling it, putting it back in. In the dusty desert summer up here, it just cakes them, man. There's so much dust and it's so light that they don't last long. But I figured while we were here, while we had the bike in the position that it was in, I might as well go ahead and take the time and throw the new uni on. I love unis, got them on all my bikes. Now that this one's going to be on this one, I'll truly have a uni filter on all my bikes. So, pretty awesome filters. I'll show you some of the differences once I get this one pulled off and that one open. Okay, so let's go over the differences between the stock air cleaner and the uni and why I prefer them. So the number one thing and the number one reason why I like the uni, says it right there, made in USA. These are made in California, have been for years. I like that. I support America. I support the working people in America. So if I can buy an American product, I do so. So second, the mating surface on the stock filter is one layer. It has like a little lip so that it goes around the cage or whatever. But it's just one layer, this thickness from the line right there to the top. And that's the whole thickness of your mating surface. This little lip that folds over just goes around the cage. But that's the whole thickness of your mating surface. Well, if you look at the uni, you can see it's double layered. So there's this one whole layer in here, and then this layer here, and it's got some ribbing in it with extra tall pouches on it to help seal. So the sealing on unis is just amazing because it has like a huge amount of sealing surface compared to the stock one. And then second is all uni filters are two filtration systems. So the yellow has got a wider, more open filter, and then opposite. The red has got a more open foam, more open filter, and then the yellow is a tighter, finer mesh. So what doesn't get caught in the red will get caught in the yellow. It's dual all the way around, two layers of foam all the way around. And it's just amazing. I've ridden through, you know, just like this one's just terrible, dusty and everything. I've ridden through this kind of stuff with my bikes in dusty races where I just can't even barely see, choking on the dirt when I get done with the race. And I've never found dirt inside the intake area of my bike running these. So those are the differences and why I like the uni filters. Made in America, great parts. They are made really high quality. The one that I have on my 250 has got 100 hours on it. One filter. I only have one filter for my bikes. I'm not one of those guys that buys 10 filters and then just changes them when they get dirty. I take the filter off, I clean it, dry it, put it back on the bike. So all my bikes just have one air filter. So that air filter on the 250 has literally been on there for 100 hours. You know, the one on my 450 has been there for whatever it is, 70, 80 hours that I have on that bike. So this one, starting at 75 hours that we have on this one now, this will be the filter for it. And well, I don't imagine it'll be any different than the other bikes and last a long time and hold up real good because it's made quality. And now here we go. That's why I choose uni. That's why I run them. I'm not sponsored by uni. Uni is not a sponsor of mine. I've asked to be sponsored and they've never responded in anything. But to me, a sponsorship is just a assistant to a company that I already like, right? Like I would like to assist them and sell more product because I enjoy using their product and that's why I chose them. Not, I'm going to run yada yada filter because they gave me a discount on them and I'm going to run those now. That's not how I work. Everything I run, I like and I use first and then I try and get sponsored by the companies of the products I like. So let's throw this on. All right, there we go. The uni is slapped on, all tightened down, and ready to go. So, I think now it's just the tires, the piston and rings, and that'll be it. Packing's done, air cleaner's done. So I took care of the easy, simple stuff first. I'll probably do the engine next, and then the pain in the butt tires will be last. I did pick up a couple of Tusk tubes, just to have over here in case I pinch one. Anytime I'm running tubes, like in this bike, because it's lightweight and because of the way it is, running high pressures in the tires, I don't worry about flats or puncture or anything. I haven't had any issues, you know, knock on wood, cross my fingers, thank Jesus, that I haven't had any flats or anything. So I'm not going to go to a moose or anything. I'm just going to go ahead and keep running the tubes. I don't know if it's the lightweightness of the bike or having the air pressures up so high compared to what I'm used to that it doesn't seem to puncture or get flats. I don't hurt the rims or anything. So we're just going to keep rocking like that until something happens that makes me decide otherwise.